have your Bibles today, I'd like you to turn to Ephesians chapter 6 as we continue our study in the book of Ephesians, and we're continuing talking about relationships, and today we talk about family and work relationships, looking at the first 9 verses in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 1 through 9. Ephesians 6, 1 through 9. Verse 1, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with a promise, that it may go well with you and that you may enjoy long life on the earth. And fathers, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord. Slaves, obey your earthly masters with respect and fear and with sincerity of heart, not as you would obey Christ. Obey them not only to win their favor when their eye is on you, but like slaves of Christ, doing the will of God from your heart. Serve wholeheartedly as if you were serving the Lord, not men, because you know that the Lord will reward everyone for whatever good he does, whether he is slave or free. And masters, treat your slaves in the same way. Do not threaten them, since you know that he who is both their master and yours is in heaven, and there is no favoritism with him. Let's say a prayer together. Father, we come to you today looking at relationships again. And Lord, sometimes we forget that the most vital relationships are in our own homes. The relationship between a husband and wife, between children and parents, and between families and their relatives. And we just pray, Lord, that you open our eyes to see how we can become better in our relationships in our home life. And Lord, we also have work relationships that we go to each day as we do our jobs. And sometimes, Lord, the relations there are strained between fellow workers and between employers and workers. And we just pray, Lord, we'll find the principles that help us to become better workers and also, Lord, to be a representative of you in that work situation. Guide us now as we study your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, we've been looking at this whole idea of relationships, and we said that followers of Jesus Christ develop good relationships in their marriages, in their home lives, their work demands, and daily contacts. And we said the main ingredient for these good relationships is this principle Paul sets down in Ephesians 5:21, submitting to one another in the love of Christ. And we said the submitting there is not becoming a doormat. It means that you are choosing to cooperate. You're choosing to show respect toward the other person. You're choosing to have a give-and-take relationship and allow that relationship to thrive, because the most important thing is your relationship with Jesus Christ. And so he said over these last several weeks that mutual submission out of reverence for Christ is the key to all good relationships. And we'll further that as we look at the home and work relationships today. And this kind of humility can't just happen in our own power. We need the power of the Holy Spirit to make it happen, as Ephesians 5:18 tells us. So this approach to relationships works in family interactions and also in employer and employee relations. And that's what we're looking at here in Ephesians chapter 6. So follow along as we go through this at a fairly rapid pace, and I hope that you'll be able to use these in your relationships at home and at work. First thing we want to look at is parents and children have responsibilities in the home that create good relationships. And sometimes we forget that. Sometimes as parents we forget we have certain responsibilities, and we just assume everything should go our way. And sometimes children forget that parents brought them into this world, and they have some rightful oversight in their lives, and the children forget their responsibility to be obedient to their parents. So let's look at responsibilities that parents and children have in this relationship with one another. Let's look first of all at the responsibility of children. Responsibility of children. Notice verses 1 through 3 say, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with a promise, so it may go well with you and that you may enjoy long life on the earth. Now, as you look at that, we're going to break it down and see what a child's responsibility is in the home. The first duty of the child is to obey. Paul writes, obey your parents. Obey your parents. And by obedience, it means listening to and carrying out orders and commands that are given in the home. It's a readiness and a willingness to hear and act when the parents give guidelines for the child to respond. Former President Gerald Ford said there were three rules in his house. One was always tell the truth. Number two was work hard. And number three was never be late to the dinner table. If you were, watch out. And that was the guidelines in his home. And he learned to live and abide by those. And every child will learn the rules and regulations in their own home, and they'll abide by those with obedience. It means a willingness to do what you're told. No questions asked. Now, as you get older, questions will come, and you can have those kind of conversations. But as a child, the best thing to do is do as mom and dad say. Now, there's several reasons why Paul says this is important, and one is one reason for obedience is that it is the Christian thing to do. And we use that phrase, in the Lord. Obey your parents in the Lord. Paul's assuming this is a Christian home, and he's telling them that, look, we obey our parents because we are obedient to Christ as well. As we follow Jesus Christ, we also want to show that example in our own walk with our parents as children. And just look back at Jesus' own life. We love him and choose to serve him by obeying our parents. Remember the story in the Bible where Jesus had gone to Jerusalem with his family for the celebration of the festival, and when everybody left, Jesus stayed at the temple. And after a couple days, Mary and Joseph were looking around with all the relatives, and Jesus wasn't with them, so they had to go back to Jerusalem, and they found him there in the temple. And Mary had some pointed questions, and Jesus said, why are you surprised? I'm here at my father's house. And after that, it says that he went home with them, and the scripture says that he was subject to them. In other words, he obeyed them, even though he knew he was the Son of God. He chose to be obedient. And then Paul gives another reason. Not only should we do it because obey because it's in the Lord, but also it's the natural thing to do. He says, for this is right. Amen. For this is right. It's the natural thing to do. Nature teaches us this. Confucius, the Chinese philosopher, built his whole system of ethical thought around this principle. And Chinese society is still strong because of his emphasis on family obedience. And then we think of nature itself. It shows that offspring obey their parents. We had a bird come on the porch and establish a nest, and by the time I got around to cleaning the nest out, there were already some eggs in there, so I didn't have the heart to tear it out. And so we had to wait for the bird, and Mama and Dad Bird kept bringing all the things in, and finally the babies were born, and they were feeding the babies. And then one day, I happened to look out, and one of the little birds fell out of the nest and was bouncing around on the back porch, and Mama Bird was hopping around going, come here, come here. That was bird language. I could understand. And she showed the way out, and the little bird followed, and next thing, Mama flew up on the chair, and little baby bird flew up on the chair that was out in the yard, and then after that, over the next several days, the other babies were born. They went through the same process. What were they doing? They were following Mama and doing what Mama showed them how to do. It's just a natural thing, right? And Paul says, look, this is the natural thing to do. It's right for children to be obedient to their parents because all of nature follows that process as well. Now, there's a second thing he says that children are to do, and that is they're to honor their parents. They're to honor their parents. Honor your father and your mother. So what's that mean? Well, it means to serve them, to love them, but also to esteem them, to hold them in high respect. It's the attitude of obedience. You don't do it just because it's a duty. You do it because you love your parents. And you want to please your parents. Just like we want to please our Father in heaven, as a child, we want to please our parents, our mom and our dad. And so Paul says, honor your father and mother. Now, he gives a practical reason for this. And the reason for this is that the Bible promises long life to a child who obeys his parents. The Bible promises long life to a child that obeys his parents. Notice he says, so it may be well with you, and you may enjoy long life on the earth. Now, we don't think about this too often, but it's an important concept that we need to recognize. The idea here is that the habitual practice of honor produces good character, which allows for a productive, fruitful, and law-abiding life. That's the principle behind this. But those who disrespect their parents usually disrespect authority all of their lives. And they end up either dead, jailed, or defeated. And I could ask you in your own walk on this earth to think about people that are always defying authority and ask yourself, how is their life as an adult?
That's right. Amen.
And you'll find that for most part, they're in troubled situations.
Yes.
And I've dealt with children as I've taught them in school or seen them in the church. And when they have this defiance against authority, it's something they carry with them all their lives. And it doesn't matter if you're trying to help them to get better. They'll continually do the opposite because they want to do it their way rather than anybody else's way. Even if it means they keep slamming their head against the wall and end up wounded and bloody. No, what we find here is that a child who honors his parents has a good life in store. That child builds character principles that will last them for life. There was a teacher that had children draw pictures of an animal they'd most like to be. And one little girl drew a picture of a deer. And the teacher said, why did you draw that? And she said, because deer are pretty and they can jump over fences and run around free in the forest. So at the parent-teacher conference, the teacher told the girl's father, your daughter has a problem. Your family is too repressive. You have too many rules. You need to let her loose. Let her out of the fences that she wants to get out of and bound around and jump free. And the father looked at the teacher and said, well, I have a son who likes deer, and you weren't here when he came through school. Otherwise, you would have known he just about tore this place up. And the reason why was because you didn't have any fences, and when he found out that, he just ran wild. But at home, we have no problem with our children because we have fences. And I have a desire to turn my daughter into someone who's not breaking down things, but building things. You may not want fences here at school, but we're keeping ours at home. And so we have to understand that some of the rules and regulations that are in the home are there for our own good. And children, when they learn that and are obedient to their parents, they end up with lives that are blessed as a result of that. Well, that's the responsibility of children, to obey and honor. But what about the responsibility of parents? Notice what Paul writes here. He says, fathers, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord. Now, just to let you know, this is Father's Day, so this is good advice for fathers, but it also applies to moms, okay? But Paul's addressing fathers here in his mind based upon what he wrote about earlier, that the father is the head of the house. And so he says, fathers, don't exasperate your children. Now, what does that mean? Well, there's other translations that kind of bring it out. And basically what they're saying is there's a negative to avoid. Don't exasperate your children. Don't provoke your children to anger. I think King James says, don't provoke your children to wrath. Okay? And the idea here is, don't be so heavy-handed that you cause frustration in your children. That they don't know which way to turn. Because you're always down on them. You're always yelling at them. You're always angry at them. And so the result is, the child is completely exasperated and frustrated. In other words, don't overcorrect them. Don't irritate them. don't rouse your children to resentment, because children are humans also, and they need to be treated with respect and dignity. Isn't that the idea behind mutual submission? Amen. That we're to treat our children, not as equals, but with same respect and dignity that we want to be treated with. You see, Paul's talking about a parent that is hasty and rough and moody in their treatment of children, so that the child becomes confused and defensive and defiant. And the result of that kind of confusion creates many problems. I have a relative who's bipolar, and some of the diagnosis behind that was he had alcoholic parents. My aunt and uncle were alcoholics. And when he was growing up, it was either everything was happy and fun and exciting, and let's go and do all these things, or it was everybody's dead drunk, nothing's happening, it's sober and gloomy and dark, and there's no joy in the household. So he had all these swings, and the swings were dependent upon whether their parents were alcohol-free or not. And so he grew up with that same kind of mood swing personality in his own life. He didn't have any kind of guidance and direction. And you see, Paul is especially pointing to fathers because he says, you know, fathers, you tend to lose your tempers a little bit more than maybe mom would. But it still applies to both parents. There's a quote by Robert Stonger. He says this: authority is more a matter of consistency than force. It may be said that consistency is authority. It takes great energy and thought for parents to be consistent in the organization and discipline involved in family life. Doing what they want, when they want, is what many parents do to demonstrate their authority. This is inconsiderate, immature, and a poor model for children. When schedules, discipline, events, and consequences all revolve around the moods and impulses of parents, children live in a state of uncertainty and even fear. So our authority must rest not in our mood swings. Authority has to come from consistent guidelines that we lay down for our children. One of my seminary professors, Dr. Newport, tells of a time he was preaching a sermon on the Father above and God's love for us. And he was preaching to some girls at a girls' reformatory. And the chaplain came up to him afterwards and he says, that sermon's not very effective here. And Dr. Newport was a little upset. He goes, what do you mean? The chaplain said, well, most of these girls either had no father or were abused by their father. And so they don't understand what you're talking about. They don't understand what it means to have consistent love and discipline in the home. And so they couldn't conceive of a heavenly father who loved them. Fleiss Wakerman writes, fathers are important. 29% of women who grew up without fathers at home say they have significant marital problems, compared with only 18% who grew up with fathers. 1 in 5 fatherless women never marry, compared with 1 in 3 among those who grew up with dads. 45% of the fatherless see themselves as ambitious, compared with 69% of the controlled group. Fathers are important. And consistency is important in the home. And so Paul says, fathers, don't provoke your children. Don't exasperate them. Don't make them feel like they have no idea what's going on in the home. Negative, rash, inconsistent leadership creates anger and rebellion. So we need those consistent guidelines and rules. Now, many of you are familiar with Martin Luther, the Reformation pastor. But what you may not know is that he had a severe abusive father. I mean, a very harsh father who beat him all the time. So Luther grew up thinking that he couldn't understand his heavenly father because he was severe and wrathful. It's probably one of the reasons he went through such a spiritual struggle. But when he became a father, he decided, okay, I'm going to do what the scripture says, spare the rod, spoil the child. I'm going to make sure my children have discipline. But he always kept an apple next to the paddle because it was to remind him, I'm not to beat these kids, I'm to discipline the kids and then let them know I love them as well. That's the negative side. Well, what about the positive side of parenting? And the positive is to affirm. In other words, nurture. Bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord. Bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord. Nurture is a careful, consistent guideline that requires time and rules. And there's two parts of this nurture. There's discipline and there's admonition. Discipline requires correction for wrongs. Admonition is giving instruction for living right. So there's a balance there in the home. Discipline means you might have spankings, groundings, restrictions. Admonition means listening, communicating, sharing, doing things together. You have to have the balance. Provide a home with rules and a home that has love in it.
Amen.
Nurture is like cutting back a plant. You prune it and you fertilize a plant because by doing that, it grows even stronger. James Dobson talked about setting some rules for his daughter in the home. And he said that his wife and daughter were arguing all the time about getting places on time and not doing her assignments on time. So Dobson said, rather than yell and scream at my daughter, what we did was we set up a checklist, and we set up a certain time it had to be done and when the cleaning times were to be done, and she would check those off and each time, and she knew exactly what she had to do. Took away all the arguments, and it gave some discipline in that girl's life. I remember my father tried to teach me when I was younger, too. And I think I've told the story before, but I'll tell it again. I couldn't wait to get a new baseball mitt because I was borrowing all my friends' baseball mitts. And I was probably 7 or 8 years old, and I kept saying, Dad, I want a baseball mitt, a baseball mitt. So for my birthday, I got a baseball glove, and I was so proud of that thing. And we oiled it, and we wrapped it, and we made sure it had a good pocket, and it was just a wonderful baseball mitt. And I love that baseball mitt. But one day, my friends came to the door and said, hey, come on, we're down the street, we're going to do something. So I ran on out and haphazardly threw my mitt in the yard and went on down the street to play. And after a few hours, I came back, and I was looking for my baseball mitt, and it wasn't there. And I looked all around the yard and went into the garage and looked in the garage and looked in the car, wasn't in the car, looked under the car, wasn't under the car. I went all around the house, and I was getting panicky now. This is my brand-new baseball mitt. Finally, my dad came out the door, and he said, you missing something? And I said, yeah, I lost my baseball mitt. And he pulled it out from behind his back and said, here it is. He said, son, I gave you this as a gift. I expect you to take good care of it. So from now on, you're going to take care of it? I said, yes, sir. I learned a lesson. And he didn't even have to raise his voice. And he didn't have to raise his hand. But I learned that lesson of discipline. You see, parents have responsibilities to raise their children. Children have responsibilities to obey their parents. A fellow named Zimmerman said, before we demand from the child something, consider what you owe them. Obedience demands love. Honor demands nurture. Care for them, for you in the old age, means that you help them inherit the promise now. We each have responsibilities in the family relationship. And let me just close with this thought, because God uses the family to fire the bricks that build the foundation of a strong society. That's where it all begins, right there. And if the family is broken down, society falls apart as well. So let's build strong families. Let's have children that cooperate with their parents and parents that lead and guide and give consistency to their children as well. Well, that brings us to the final point, and that is this, that the Christian principles of work create better workers, bosses, and relationships. And we're going to have to just kind of think about this, because by the time most Americans reach retirement, they've invested 125,000 hours of their lives in daily work. Do you realize that? That statistic is true for all who devote a minimum of 40 hours per week to their jobs or to the preparation for their jobs. 125,000 hours. So you're going to spend a lot of time on the job, and there's going to be a lot of relationships there. You're going to have some principles to guide you with. So here's what Paul says to the workers, the responsibility of workers. He says, slaves, obey your earthly masters with respect and fear and with sincerity of heart, just as you would obey Christ. Obey them not only to win their favor when their eye is on you, but as slaves of Christ, doing the will of God from your heart. Serve wholeheartedly as if you were serving the Lord, not people, because you know that the Lord will reward each one for whatever good they do, whether they are slave or free. Now immediately you say, we don't have slaves now. This doesn't apply to me. Well, let's think about that. In Paul's day, over 50% of all workers in the Roman Empire were slaves. They were the property of someone. And a lot of times, those slaves were more educated and had better quality in their lives than the owners did. And the owners would let these slaves raise their own children and teach them and instruct them and so on. So we're not talking here about slaves in the common idea of working on the chain gang. This is slaves in the sense of people that were used by these owners to make their homes better and more efficient. And you can think of Joseph in the Bible being a slave of Potiphar and how he was treated there. He was given great responsibilities, even though technically he was a slave. So what Paul is saying here is, look, let's use this slave-master principle and give some guidelines that will show us how to operate in an employer-employee relationship as we have in our day. Eventually, these principles broke down the whole system of slavery in the Roman Empire. It was like a fellow goes in the woods and strips the bark off all the tree and waits for the tree to die. This is what Paul does. He strips everything that builds up the slave system, he strips it off, and then he says, over time, if we keep practicing this, the principles of slavery will fall and the Christian principles will rise up. So let's relate these principles to the here and now in our workforce. So what's Paul say? Well, he says, if you work for someone, obey them with respect, first of all. Obey them with respect. That's the first thing that we're required to do. Years ago, there was an employee at Ford Motor Company, and he was looking for Henry Ford, and he said, how can I make my life a success? And Henry Ford said this, when you start a thing, finish it. Start a thing, finish it. And that's the idea behind this. We need to begin to work hard and respect those who are in charge of us. Have respect for the employer and have respect for yourself and your job. For instance, when you buy a new car, some people look and see when the car was mass-produced. If it was mass-produced on a Monday, they don't buy it. You know why? Because all the workers have hangovers from the weekend, and they don't want that kind of car. They don't buy it if it's built on a Friday because all the workers are looking forward to going home for the weekend and hitting the bars. So buy it in between, Tuesday through Thursday, you might get a better car, okay? But that's not treating your employer with respect if you have those kind of guidelines in your life. Paul says also, hey, look, obey your employer with commitment. In other words, commit yourself to doing the very best with respect and fear, with sincerity of heart, as you would obey Christ. And the idea behind this is that we want to make sure our commitment is to Christ and not just to our boss. Alabama football coach Bear Bryant one time was asked why he got up so early and worked so hard. And he said, well, I'm not as smart as the other coaches, so I have to work harder to catch up. And so he would get up extra early to make it happen. That was commitment to his job, to the work that he had. And then Paul goes on and says, do it with Christian devotion. Do it as unto the Lord. Do it as if you were obeying Christ. That's the idea behind this idea of Christian devotion. We've had a Bible study here about Brother Lawrence, who was complaining and griping in his monastery about having to do the dishes all the time. until he discovered that he could sing praises while he washed dishes, and that let his whole heart be free, and he learned a new walk with God and a new way to do his work. But also Paul says, do it with sincerity. There in verse 6, he says, obey them not only to win their favor when their eye is on you, but as slaves of Christ doing the will of God from the heart. And the idea here is that you're to do it with all your might, not just because they're watching you, but because you have the idea, I'm serving the Lord rather than these men. My brother-in-law, Tim Leach, worked as a technician in a nuclear plant, and he didn't have any degree, but the managers who had the degrees but didn't have any technical knowledge would always come to him to solve the technical problems. And then when the problems were solved, they took the credit for it, and he never got noticed for the job he did. And he had to come to the conclusion, I'm working for the Lord, not for those men. And that let him be able to do his job well. And I remember I was working a grain elevator, and it would come time toward the 10 o'clock break, and some of the workers would stop working 15 minutes before the break and get ready for their break. And then after the break, they'd take another 15 minutes to kind of get back into the routine of things. So that was like a half an hour of working without working. And I was over there pushing away, you know, and I was a seminary student trying to do my very best, working hard for the Lord. And finally, one of them came up to me and says, take it slow. This is an all-day job. Okay? But no, we have to have sincerity. We have to do our job well and do it as unto the Lord. And with a good attitude, with a good attitude, Paul says, have the right attitude when you're doing it, doing the will of God from your heart. Do you know the people that built the Notre Dame Cathedral? The cathedral took almost 100 years to build, and there were several generations that came and went in the process. Sometimes fathers, sons, and grandfathers all worked in the cathedral, and then they would pass on. That had to take a different attitude, didn't it? To know that the work I'm doing now may not be complete, this big cathedral, but yet they had the right attitude doing it for the Lord. And then Paul says, do it with proper motivation. Notice he says, serve wholeheartedly as if you're serving the Lord, not people, because you know the Lord will reward each one for whatever good they do, whether they're a slave or whether they are free. And Paul is bringing out this idea that you do it as you're doing it for Christ, not for your boss. When George Washington Carver was doing his work, he said, I discover nothing in my laboratory. If I come here of myself, I'm lost. But I can do all things through Christ. With my prayers, I mix my labors, and sometimes God is pleased to bless the results. That's the proper motivation to have, to do it under the Lord. You see, why does Paul give these guidelines? He says this, the primary sin of the worker is a lack of honest effort. It's a lack of honest effort. He says, obey them, not only to win their favor when their eye is on you, but as slaves of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart. We don't need to be like the fellow the foreman caught with his eyes closed on the job. And the foreman said, what do you think you're doing? And the man opened one eye, looked at the foreman, and said, what's the matter, sir? He said, can't a guy say a prayer once in a while? Okay. He wasn't saying prayers. He was sleeping on the job. We have to have the proper attitude because that's the primary sin of a worker, is a lack of honest effort doing their very best. So the cure is to work for Jesus as your boss and not your employers or a paycheck. If somebody's down on their job and they don't like their job, they don't like their work, I keep asking them, look, who are you working for? You working for a paycheck? You're going to be miserable. You working for the boss? You're going to be miserable. If you work for the Lord, he'll get you through. And he'll give you joy where you didn't have any joy. I've tried to let my children know this as well. Serve wholeheartedly as if you're serving the Lord, not people. And if you have that kind of attitude and response, you'll have joy in your work. But he doesn't close with just the workers. He also says, hey, there's a responsibility for employers as well. Masters, treat your slaves in the same way. Do not threaten them, since you know that he who is both their master and yours is in heaven. And there's no favoritism with him. What's he saying here to the masters, those who are the employers? If you employ someone or supervise someone, treat them with respect and treat them with integrity. Let them know that you're concerned about them and treat them with that kind of respect. You know, in the 1800s, there were a lot of unfair labor conditions that were going on. Children were working 12, sometimes 16 hours a day. People were working 6 days a week, and Sunday all they did was end up sleeping, and the children weren't even going to school. It allowed for the rise of communism and the social movement, social workers movement. But along the way comes some Christian people who began to say, this isn't right. This isn't right. And so they began to get fair labor laws, and they began to get shorter work weeks enacted and get shorter hours enacted. Groups like OSHA were formed in the government to make sure working conditions were done correctly, all because employers had forgotten to treat their workers with respect and integrity. Workers are not just a cog in a machine, and we still need to remember that and remind our employers about that. And then Paul says, hey, do it with Christian devotion. Do it with Christian devotion. Remember, you have to answer to someone. You have to answer to someone. Mary Kay Cosmetics is a big cosmetic company, and it's been noted for a lot of things. But it operates on the golden rule. And Howard Business School uses her book as a new idea in business. Her aim is to provide her sellers with every means to become successful. Who could have thought of that? The employer wants their employees to be successful. And yet that's what Mary Kay Cosmetics is built on the golden rule, Christian devotion. And finally, Paul says, employers are to employ with compassion. Compassion. The idea behind here is, look, your Father's in heaven, there's no favoritism with him, and he cares about those that follow him. It's interesting to find out that the U.S. industry finally had to go to Japan to find out why they were so successful over there in Japan. What was going on that made them so brilliant in the areas of electronics and technology like that and automobile production and so on. They went over there and began to look at it, and they found out that companies took an interest in their employees. Companies provided health care, recreation facilities, scholarships, wage incentives, and team effort practices. And that made them the leader in electronics and automobile production. Ironically, what they found out was the man who taught them this approach was the same guy who used to work for the U.S. automakers after World War II. And they said, your ways don't work here. So they fired him. He went to Japan. And we know the rest is history, as Japan took off and America fell behind. So we need to be someone who provides compassion with our workers, to treat them well and give them the very best. Amen. The primary sin of the employer is to abuse the position of authority. The cure is to remember God is your boss and treats you the same way he treats your workers. If you have that kind of humility and that kind of attitude, and you treat someone with that kind of respect, then your job situation will be a lot better, whether you're an employer or an employee. As we close today, as we think about Father's Day, God has given each one of us major responsibilities in our relationships, in the home and on the job. Are you serving the Lord in those areas? Let's pray together. As we close this morning, Father, our prayer is that each one of us may come to this understanding that it's not about having my own way and doing things the way I want to. It's about treating others with respect and dignity, cooperating with them, and working to make a win-win situation for all, whether it's in the home or whether it's on the job. I pray each one of us here, Father, will do our very best to be a servant of Christ in the place where we find ourselves. In his name we pray. Amen. We're going to stand and sing our hymn of invitation this morning as we close our service. We're going to sing, I Need Thee Every Hour. And the Lord may have spoken to you in some way today. Whatever that is, you come and respond to his call. Let's stand together as we sing.